Warm welcome from my side to all of you to my webinar about AUTOSAR security and how to use AUTOSAR to holistically secure your vehicle. First of all, one or two words to my person. I'm Michael Schneider. I'm working as a security consultant and project manager for S-Script for 5 years now. And within my role as a security consultant, I'm working with automotive OEMs and tier ones to support them in order to secure their ECU and their vehicle. And I have a special focus on AUTOSAR security, also supporting here the OEMs and tier ones with their AUTOSAR security topics. And as part of this role, I'm also a member of the AUTOSAR consortium within, so I'm working within the AUTOSAR working group security. The topics that I'm going to present to you today are based on the experience that we've gained with our numerous projects with OEMs and tier ones, and also from our experience with our mother company ETAS, which is also a longstanding member of the AUTOSAR consortium. Okay, let's now get started with the webinar. This is the outline of today's talk. So first of all, I will give you a short introduction. Afterwards, we will deep dive into AUTOSAR security topics, where I will give you an overview over the security building blocks that are offered within AUTOSAR. Afterwards, we will discuss how these building blocks can be used in order to secure your ECU and your EE network. And in the end, we will then discuss what else is needed in order to holistically secure your ECU. And we will also have an outlook into topics that are currently ongoing within the AUTOSAR consortium. And after that, I think we should still have some time to do a Q&A. Okay, let's get started. Let's get started with the introduction. And I would like to begin here with a brief history lesson. And I would like to start with the history of the EE architecture. When we now look back at the 50s, the car was basically an all-mechanic car. So electronics was only available in these cars for things like radio or lights. This changed in the subsequent decades when more and more electronics and ECUs were into the car, which also sparked the development of technologies like the CAN bus in the 80s and 90s. That this development of an increasing number of ECUs was also addressed by the automotive industry by founding the AUTOSAR consortium in 2002. AUTOSAR had the goal to provide a standardized middleware for this increasing number of ECUs. So also in a broader context, AUTOSAR had the idea to standardize the EE architecture. When we now look again at the subsequent years, we can see that the idea of AUTOSAR was a right idea, was a correct idea, because the numbers of ECU continued to increase. And it was also shown that AUTOSAR had made the right decisions because AUTOSAR became the go-to middleware for automotive ECUs. When we now look at today, the EE architecture is changing again due to new use cases like the connected vehicle or automated driving. And these developments are also addressed by the AUTOSAR consortium with the development of adaptive AUTOSAR, which was released in 2018 and which is specifically developed to support these new EE architectures. Next, I would like to give a brief introduction on the history of automotive security. Automotive security didn't start in the 50s, but rather in the 90s with first R&D topics on automotive security. And it was also in the 90s that the first electronic immobilizers were introduced. So immobilizers that were not only relying on your physical key fob, but where some additional electronics was introduced into the key fob in order to authenticate it towards the vehicle. Automotive security continued to gain interest and also led to the foundation of several companies dedicated on automotive security, one being the S-Script GmbH, which was founded in 2002 as a spin-off of the Chair for Embedded Security of the Ruhr Universität Bochum. And it was also in the 2000s that more and more security use cases were introduced into the vehicle, for instance, component theft protection. When we now look again at today, security is pretty much in the focus of the automotive market. This is on the one hand due to prominent hacks like GPEG that have shown that cars are vulnerable, but on the other hand also due to legislative reasons like the UNECE that force OEMs and tier ones to take security seriously. And also the these new use cases that I've shown before, like the connected vehicle and automated driving, these new use cases also needs to be secured. So these use cases also pose requirements with regards to the security of the vehicle. Okay, last slide on history. After that, we are getting into the topic. Security in AUTOSAR. With the first release of classic AUTOSAR in 2005, there were no security modules present within AUTOSAR, and each OEM had to manage its vehicle security requirements on its own, independently of AUTOSAR. This changed in 2010 when the first security module was introduced in AUTOSAR, the CSM. So starting at this point, the OEM could use a standardized building block that's available within AUTOSAR in order to fulfill its security requirements. In the subsequent years, more and more security modules were added to AUTOSAR, with one hallmark being again the release of Adaptive AUTOSAR in 2018, where a whole new set of security features were introduced into AUTOSAR. So today, the OEM can rely on AUTOSAR and use this number of security building blocks that are available in order to implement its own security requirements. However, the OEM has still to fulfill some of these requirements on its own because they are OEM-specific, like the OEM-specific realization of an immobilizer. However, most of these requirements can be fulfilled by the standardized modules that are available in AUTOSAR. And today I would like to address this question to how can these modules be used in order to build a secure vehicle and to construct secure ECUs. Okay, let's now start with a deep dive. Let's start with having a look at the AUTOSAR security building blocks. Before we go into the security part, first of all, one or two words about AUTOSAR in general. First of all, who is AUTOSAR? AUTOSAR is an industry consortium that consists of over 200 partners. Basically, every big automotive OEM in Tier 1 is a partner of AUTOSAR. We can see here some of the companies, where on the left-hand side, you can also see the 9 core partners, which were also the founding partners of the AUTOSAR consortium. Next, what is AUTOSAR? AUTOSAR is a standardized middleware for automotive ECUs, and it comes in two variants nowadays, classic AUTOSAR and adaptive AUTOSAR. Classic AUTOSAR is focusing on typical automotive use cases like safety and real-time, whereas adaptive AUTOSAR is focusing more on these new use cases like connectivity and automated driving. So adaptive AUTOSAR is supporting more performant use cases while still providing safety to a certain extent. Now, I would like to point out that adaptive AUTOSAR was not meant to replace classic AUTOSAR, but both are meant to coexist next to each other. In fact, both can even coexist next to each other within one ECU, as we can see here on the right-hand side. We can see here an example architecture of a vehicle computer that contains a microcontroller and a microprocessor. The microcontroller hosts one instance of classic AUTOSAR, where applications with high safety requirements are running. And the microprocessor runs a hypervisor, which in turn hosts several instances of different OSs. So we can see here again, one instance of classic AUTOSAR that runs safety-related applications. We can see two instances of adaptive AUTOSAR, for instance, one instance for the V2X communication, the other instance for automated driving. And there could even be a non-AUTOSAR OS running there, for instance, a Linux platform that's running applications from the infotainment domain. Now, in the introduction, I have said that AUTOSAR is the go-to middleware. So why is that so? Why is AUTOSAR so broadly used? Well, first of all, AUTOSAR was designed for the automotive market. It was designed to address typical automotive use cases like real-time, like safety. Second, AUTOSAR was also designed to fit the typical automotive supply chains. So AUTOSAR is not only the middleware, AUTOSAR is also a methodology that foresees roles for the OEM and for the tier one. And AUTOSAR also provides a requirements exchange format, the RxML, that's standardized and that's used all around the automotive industry to exchange requirements between the OEM and the tier one. And third reason why AUTOSAR is so broadly used, AUTOSAR has also a strong focus on security. We will see that in a second in more detail, but one highlight I can also show you here, that is SecOC. SecOC is a module that is used to secure in-vehicle traffic. SecOC was specifically designed for automotive bus systems, and SecOC was designed and specified within the AUTOSAR consortium. Okay, let's now have a look at the security building blocks that are available within AUTOSAR. Let's start with the crypto stack. The crypto stack is a basic functionality, offers a basic functionality that is used by basically every application that implements a security use case. For instance, you have an application that has to store confidential data like a credit card number for a charging application, and this data has to be encrypted in order to prohibit unauthorized access. And the application can use the crypto stack to fulfill this use case. So the crypto stack provides access to cryptographic primitives and to cryptographic keys via standardized interfaces. The actual implementation is further below. The implementation could be done within a software library, or the implementation could be done within an HSM. However, this is all the same for the application because the crypto stack provides standardized interfaces towards the application and does all the translation work to the cryptolib or the HSM. Since the crypto stack is such a basic functionality, it's available in both platforms, Classic and Adaptive AUTOSAR. The next building block is also pretty straightforward. It's secure communication, and I think basically, every OEM has the use case that they want to secure some part of their in-vehicle communication. For instance, you have the unlock doors message as part of your anti-theft system. That needs to be authenticated such that the door control module is sure that this open doors message was really sent by the sender it's expecting. However, with these new use cases of the connected vehicle, modern cars are communicating more and more with external entities, and these connections also need to be secured because private data like the vehicle position could be transmitted, and this use case is also supported by AUTOSAR. So what does AUTOSAR offer here? It's three different security protocols that are supported by AUTOSAR. It's SecOC, TLS, and IPsec. SecOC, I've said that before, is an AUTOSAR proprietary protocol that can be used to secure in-vehicle communication. TLS and IPsec are protocols that originate from the enterprise sector and are now adapted by the automotive market. And they both can be used to protect on-board traffic and also off-board traffic. With the current release of AUTOSAR, R2011, all of these three modules are available in both platforms, Classic and Adaptive AUTOSAR. The next building block is secure diagnostics. So assume you have an application running on your ECU that manages sensible data like your immobilizer, and some of this data has to be available via the diagnostic interface in order to solve problems with your module. However, this data might give additional insight to an attacker, so you want to protect this data from unauthorized access. And this use case is also supported by AUTOSAR by two UDS services. It's service 27 and 29, so security access, where you can protect your interface via a challenge response protocol, and it's 29, where you can also use a challenge response protocol, or you can also use the certificate-based authentication scheme. This use case is also pretty basic. I think every OEM has this use case. So this functionality is also available in both platforms, Classic and Adaptive AUTOSAR. The next building block is not so easy to explain. So I would like to go more into detail here what kind of attack we're going to protect here with identity and access management. So assume we have an ECU that runs an instance of AUTOSAR where we have two applications. We have the GPS tracker that provides the GPS history of your vehicle to applications. And we have an insurance app that wants to access this data as part of your insurance plan. Now let's assume that there's a third application running on your AUTOSAR, which is some untrusted third-party gaming application. And this application might be compromised, and now it wants to access the GPS history of your vehicle. Clearly, this is something that you do not want to happen because this is personal data and should not be shared with some third-party gaming app. And this is where identity and access management comes into play. Identity and access management manages a policy that states which services can be accessed by which application. So in this case, the policy would state that the insurance app is allowed to access this GPS history, whereas the gaming app is not allowed to access this interface. So in this case, the GPS tracker would query the identity and access management and receive as an answer that the gaming app is not allowed to access this data. So the GPS history will not be provided to the gaming app. So in a nutshell, what does identity and access management do? It identifies applications and authorizes them to access specific services. Due to architectural constraints, this module is only available in Adaptive AUTOSAR, but not in Classic AUTOSAR. Okay, the next building block is quite new. It's the Intrusion Detection System Manager, and this was only introduced with the last release of AUTOSAR, R2011 from last year. Before we go into detail what AUTOSAR offers here, I would first of all like to give a brief introduction into what an intrusion detection system is and what it's needed for. So the first thing that you need for an intrusion detection, for an IDS, are IDS sensors. So you need modules that monitor resources on your ECU to identify security incidents on host and network level. The other part that you need within your IDS is the VSOC, so the Vehicle Security Operation Center. So this means that you have a team of security experts within the office that analyzes the security events raised by the IDS sensors, and this team then can decide about possible countermeasures. What's missing here is the way how these events are transported from the sensor to the VSOC, and this is the task of your in-vehicle distributed IDS. So this distributed IDS collects security incidents, performs some pre-analysis, and performs the communication with the backend. And we can see here one example architecture of such an in-vehicle distributed IDS. We can see the IDSM that is available on every ECU. The IDSM collects, filters, aggregates, qualifies security events raised on this ECU, and forwards these qualified security events to the IDSR, that's the IDS reporter, and the IDS reporter is then in charge of communicating with the VSOC. So what's available in AUTOSAR here? Available in AUTOSAR is the IDSM, so the aggregation module that is that aggregates on ECU level. But in addition, AUTOSAR also provides a set of IDS sensors that are implemented within specific modules of the AUTOSAR stack, for instance, in the CAN stack or the Ethernet stack, in order to raise network security events. We have just seen that the VSOC analyzes events and decides about countermeasures. One such countermeasure could be that, or one event could be that they have identified that there's a vulnerability in one of the firmwares, and they want to deploy a patched firmware over the air to all vehicles. This use case is also supported by AUTOSAR. So how this usually happens is that the OEM prepares a vehicle update campaign. So every ECU receives a vehicle update package that contains a number of different firmwares. This vehicle update package is then processed by the UCM master on Adaptive AUTOSAR, which verifies the authenticity of this vehicle update package and distributes the firmwares to the respective receiving ECUs. On the receiving ECU that runs Adaptive AUTOSAR, this firmware is then handled by the UCM client, which does again checks with regarding to the authenticity and with regards to downgrade protection, and afterwards performs the update of your Adaptive AUTOSAR stack. On classic AUTOSAR, this firmware has, as of today, be handled by an OEM-specific footer module. So this use case is not yet standardized in classic AUTOSAR. However, there are currently activities ongoing in order to introduce this use case also to classic. The last building block that I'm going to present to you is the trusted platform. What does it do? Assume that you have, again, an instance of AUTOSAR running different applications, and now an attacker managed to modify one of your applications such that it executes malicious code. This is something that you do not want to happen and must be prevented at all costs. And this is what the trusted platform does. So let's see how this works. We have here one ECU that contains a trust anchor that's realized in hardware, for instance, in an HSM. And first of all, this trust anchor verifies that your AUTOSAR stack it verifies the integrity of your AUTOSAR stack. And within the AUTOSAR stack, execution management takes over the responsibility of starting then the applications. And trusted platform is part of the execution management. So what happens now is that the trusted platform verifies the integrity of your original application, turns out that everything is fine, so the execution management starts this application. Afterwards, the trusted platform checks if the integrity of the modified app is valid, and this check fails, so this application will not be started by execution management, thus keeping your platform trusted. Okay, again, in a nutshell, what does trusted platform do? It verifies the integrity of your applications before they are being started. One important point here is that the trusted platform is relying on some hardware-based trust anchor as a root of trust. This trust anchor could be realized, for instance, by an HSM. Again, this functionality is only available in Adaptive AUTOSAR, again, due to architectural constraints. In classic AUTOSAR, you have to rely on typical implementations of secure boot for embedded devices. Okay, basically, that's it. These are the security building blocks that are available within AUTOSAR. So let's conclude this first part. First of all, we have seen that AUTOSAR is a broadly used standard in the automotive industry. It comes in two variants nowadays, classic AUTOSAR for safety and real-time aspects, Adaptive AUTOSAR for performance-related use cases. Both can coexist next to each other, even on one ECU. And in addition, we have seen all the security building blocks that are available within classic and Adaptive AUTOSAR, as seen here on the right-hand side. Most of them are available on both platforms, but some of them are only limited to one of the two. Okay, now that we know what AUTOSAR offers, let's now discuss how to use these building blocks properly in order to secure your ECU and your EE network. Before we go into the security aspect, I would like to take one step back and first of all, discuss how to actually build an ECU or build an EE network. So let's have a look at some generic EE network. This network contains a high number of ECUs, most of them running AUTOSAR, classic or adaptive. AUTOSAR These ECUs are provided by different suppliers. AUTOSAR might even be provided by different stakeholders, the so-called stack vendors. And when we now look into one ECU specifically, we can see here that there are different modules that needs to be configured according to the respective use case. And we have then again a set of applications running on AUTOSAR that might be developed by even other stakeholders. So what I'm trying to tell you here is that building an EE network, building an ECU, is complex because you have lots of different modules, lots of different applications. Each of them might be provided by different stakeholders. So you have to manage your implementation process somehow in order to manage your timeline and to manage your risks. And what you usually do here is that you employ some software engineering process. For instance, you use the agile software engineering process. And during this engineering process, you should also consider security in order to properly secure your vehicle. So what do I mean with that? Let's have a look at how this could be realized within Agile. Within Agile, you usually start with a user story that describes some feature that needs to be implemented. The developer takes this user story and he starts writing requirements for this feature. Afterwards, he implements these requirements and in the end, he validates, so he tests whether his implementation actually fulfills the feature described in the user story. So how can I add security here? First of all, during the requirements engineering phase, you should perform a risk analysis to identify possible threats and risks that might be introduced with this new feature. And you have to also have to decide about possible countermeasures, for instance, by securing your communication. The results of this risk analysis have then to be considered in the implementation phase. And within the scope of today's talk, so it is within the scope of AUTOSAR, this means these have to be considered within your AUTOSAR configuration, for instance, for configuring a secure channel using SecOC. And in the end, you, of course, also have to test all the security requirements that you have written down. So you should perform security tests like pen tests, like code review, but you should also think about functional security tests to make sure that SecOC was implemented properly. Okay, this is still a bit high level, so let's have an even deeper look based on one example. Let's have a look at the example, how to secure your onboard communication with SecOC. How do you do that? First, you start with the risk analysis part. So you take the K matrix of your vehicle and you go through every message and identify the messages that need to be secured. And also at this early stage, you also have to determine the protection level that you assign each message because SecOC can be configured on a very fine granular level. For every message, you can configure MAC length, freshness value, and so on. And these decisions should already be done at the very first step during your risk analysis. After you have identified all the messages, you can go to the next step of the AUTOSAR configuration. So you have to configure your SecOC module, but you also have to configure your complete crypto stack because SecOC is relying on crypto primitives, and you have also have to configure all the keys that are needed for your secure communication channels. This AUTOSAR configuration is usually carried out using appropriate toolchain, for instance, using the ISOLAR toolchain offered by ETAS. I would also like to point out here that this task has to be carried out with great care because even the slightest misconfiguration can lead to a non-functional SecOC. So imagine you have two ECUs that want to communicate with each other, but on the receiving side, you have referenced the wrong key or you have chosen a MAC length that differs by one byte, then the receiving ECU cannot verify the authenticity of the message and the message will be dropped. This is something you do not want to happen, and our recommendation is that you perform a review of the AUTOSAR configuration already at this early stage during the development, such that these cases are reduced as much as possible. Finally, once you've properly configured everything, you have compiled everything, you have now your firmware, you can start testing. And so you should, of course, do standard security tests. So you should perform a pen test of your ECU in order to identify possible weaknesses. You should also perform a code review of the relevant code parts, so SecOC and the crypto stack. But you should also think about functional tests of SecOC. So tests that validate that the MACs are calculated correctly, that all DTCs are set correctly, and so on. This is also a crucial part of properly testing your security functionality. Now, although it seems it's quite easy, you're going from left to right, it's not always that easy. In some cases, you also have to take one step back. For instance, when you identify a vulnerability in your pen test, you have to go back to the risk analysis part of your process because you have to address these risks. Or during your functional test, you find that there was indeed a misconfiguration and you have to go back to your AUTOSAR configuration step. However, I think this is part of day-to-day business in engineering. Still, this picture basically shows our idea of how to use AUTOSAR properly in order to properly secure your car. With this, I would like to come to the last part of today's webinar. It's about how to achieve holistic security of an ECU and also to give a brief outlook into what AUTOSAR plans to do more. So what is needed in addition to AUTOSAR in order to holistically secure your car? I would like to go into three aspects here. On the one hand, one of our recommendations is that you also think about employing hardware security in order to achieve a higher security level. But on the other hand, you should also think about the full lifecycle of your vehicle and keep all the aspects of this lifecycle in mind. So you should also think about security in the ECU production, but you should also think about keeping the car secure as soon as it's on the road. Let's have a look at each of these aspects one by one. First, hardware security. We have seen today that AUTOSAR provides a number of security building blocks for lots of use cases. However, in the end, AUTOSAR can only do so much because it's just software. And especially for critical data like cryptographic keys, you should think about using additional measures like a hardware security module. So a hardware security module is a security coprocessor that's physically separated from your host core, and thus giving you a much higher security level. HSMs are nowadays pretty much established in the automotive market, and in fact, they are also supported natively by AUTOSAR, by the crypto driver on the host side. Next, secure ECU production. As I've just said, you have to keep the full life cycle of your vehicle in mind in order to holistically secure it. And the life of your vehicle and of your ECU starts at the production. And already at this early stage, the ECU has to be provisioned with keys, for instance, to enable secure communication or to enable secure diagnostics for tester authentication, for instance. So what you need at your production plant is some secure provisioning environment, for instance, some dedicated room that's access controlled where the keys are injected into the ECU. And you also have to think about an IT system that does the management of all the keys that are injected into all your ECUs in different production lines. Finally, you also have to consider the security of your vehicle as soon as it's on the road. We have already seen here that AUTOSAR supports you here. We have seen the IDS modules that collect the events. We have seen that secure updates can be processed by AUTOSAR. However, AUTOSAR can only help you in implementing the vehicle part of these measures, but all of these security controls also need to have some security experts that are sitting in the office, that are doing the analysis, that are doing that are sending about countermeasures and so on. So this is also a very crucial part of holistically securing your car, that you have a properly managed security incidents response team in place. Finally, the outlook. What is planned within AUTOSAR? We have seen in the beginning that the EE architecture is changing due to new use cases. And one of this change is that automotive Ethernet is more and more introduced into vehicle. And this also needs additional security features in order to secure this rising number of automotive Ethernet channels. And one of these features is a firewall. A firewall can be used to block illegitimate in-vehicle traffic, and it can also be used to control the access of external entities to your in-vehicle network, for instance, to control access via the OBD port, or to control access to charging stations, and so on. Now, a firewall can be deployed in different ways. You can deploy a firewall on your Ethernet switch, but you can also deploy it on your host firewall. This actually depends on the use case that you want to fulfill with your firewall. Within AUTOSAR, of course, only the deployment on the host can be functionally specified. However, it still makes sense to also think about the switch use case within AUTOSAR, because AUTOSAR in the end is a standard. So the goal is to provide standardized firewall filter rules that may be also be applicable to a network firewall on the Ethernet switch. So this topic is currently in a very early stage. This is still pretty much in discussion within AUTOSAR, also with regards to these different deployment scenarios, what AUTOSAR can do in the end. So the firewall is only planned for the release next year, not for the release in this year. Okay, basically that's it. I'm at the end of my talk. So what have we discussed today? In the beginning, I posed the question, how can we use AUTOSAR to secure your vehicle and your ECU? And we have first of all seen that AUTOSAR is a good choice because AUTOSAR is broadly accepted and widely used in the automotive industry. And on the other hand, AUTOSAR provides also a number of security building blocks that are readily available to implement security use cases. As we can see on the right-hand side here, we can see again the different security building blocks and where they are available. Afterwards, we have also investigated how to properly configure and how to properly test your AUTOSAR security modules in order to use them correctly. And finally, we have also seen that AUTOSAR can only do so much because it's only software, and you should also think about using or employing additional security modules like hardware security modules in order to achieve holistic security. Now, before we come to the Q&A, I would like to highlight two more things. First of all, if you think that one of these use cases that I've presented today are also applicable at your site and you need support in implementing SecOC in your vehicle, we can support you here. We can support you in writing concepts and also deploying SecOC in the vehicle. On the other hand, if you think that my use case is not appearing in this list of security building blocks, we can also help you here, because AUTOSAR is an industry consortium and it's also open to new features. And if you have such a feature that needs to be added to AUTOSAR, we can also support you in this case. So if you have one of these two use cases in mind and you think that you need support, we are happy to help you here. So please visit our homepage here and contact us. Second highlight I would like to show you here is a white paper that we've written in the beginning of this year. The UNECE is currently basically everywhere because it's posing requirements on manufacturers in order to achieve So OEMs have to prove that they have considered adequate security to gain type approval. And we think that AUTOSAR can help you here to show that you've considered adequate security with its standardized building blocks. And we have analyzed this use case within our white paper using AUTOSAR to achieve UNEC compliant cybersecurity. We have also given a webinar here where you can, both of these can be found on our homepage, scrip.com. So feel free to go there and read our analysis. And if you have questions, I'm happy to ask them. That's it. That were the two highlights. So thank you for your attention.